I should like you students to think with me this morning for a few moments, if you will, on the meaning, the purpose, the significance of life, your life, on the degree to which you may be able to determine what your life is to be, and to help to achieve your destiny by your own efforts. I'd like to take as a possible text the words of John in the first chapter of his gospel. He said, "To as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God." Now, in the Mormon view, our own effort is an important agency in attaining this godlike status. John amplified and emphasized what he said in his gospel when he wrote the epistle. And he said, "Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not appear yet what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is." If we are to become like God, I think it important that we undertake, so far as it may be possible, to determine how he became what he is. What laws were operative? And what are the distinguishing features which we would like to emulate and achieve? We know, of course, that he is omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent. But there is a saying among us that the glory of God is intelligence, or in other words, light and truth. This would seem to indicate that we should walk in the light and undertake an eternal quest for truth. And by gaining knowledge and applying it with wisdom, achieve godlike intelligence. Now, your generation has come upon the earth at a time of man-made miracles, which have been variously referred to as stupendous, baffling, superhuman, godlike. And it is with respect to them that I'd like to speak for just a moment. Because we who can remember almost 100 years ago can't help comparing the world we now live in with the world we knew. If some person from another planet had come to this earth in 1856 and spent, say, 30 days among us, and if he had returned in 1956, I think it likely that his guide would have had difficulty in convincing him that he was seeing the same world. So wonderful are the changes. But I should like to speak for a few moments about an infant industry. I shall not, in mentioning the changes that have come about, refer to the common things, such as motor cars and airplanes and telephone and radio and television. I shall not even take time to refer at length to atomic bombs and H-bombs and fusion and fission, to the release of great energy measured only in megatons, or to the accompanying luminosity which exceeds 500 suns. But just last week there came to my desk from a corporation in New York, not specifically to enlighten us, but to undertake to encourage us to make some investments. And I'd like to read a few things from that report, and I'm going to read them because I'll be out of my depth if I undertake to quote them. You students of science will be familiar with what I'm going to read, as will all the faculty, of course, and our distinguished guests. But we laymen are intrigued by some things they say. The president of Bendix Aviation recently declared that electronics, in its broadest concept, is an almost miraculous extension of man's senses and abilities. That with the aid of electronics, he can see otherwise invisible things. He can hear what would otherwise be silent. He can calculate in an hour what would take a lifetime. Electronics is a practical method for sensing anything you want to sense, whether it's movement, light, temperature, pressure, humidity, practically anything, he says, but love. And I think I should warn you young men that you'd better get busy or electronics will take over there. Electronics, he continues, has already found a way to ease men's work, to brighten man's youth, speed his education, lighten his daily task, entertain his family, defend his home, and prolong his life. And he says the future of electronics appears even more baffling than its past. This is a science based on the electron, the smallest particle to be found in nature, roughly 30,000 trillion trillion electrons. That's 28 ciphers, if you'd like to write it out. 30,000 trillion trillion electrons would weigh less than 1 ounce. It's estimated it would take more electrons to weigh 1 ounce than it would take snowflakes to create a blizzard covering 500 square miles, 2,500 square miles. To light 100-watt bulb requires 6 million trillion electrons every second. What I'd like to do is to bring to you this morning the thought that stupendous as is the advancement being made, and prophetic as is the future in that field, something comparable is happening in the field of religious thinking. And God, who is in charge of all, has not allowed that area of truth to remain uncultivated. And in order that I may not be thought to be giving only the Mormon view of what is taking place in the religious field, I'm going to read again a few words from a recent author. George Harris, in his recent book, A Century of Change in Religion, in telling of that change, said, a change has come about in religious thinking in the last 50 years greater than in all the time preceding that. He says the new thought is of the kingdom of God on earth. And he adds, the gospel of the kingdom of God on earth is the latest, the newest, the oldest, and the truest gospel. And then he discusses what men are coming more and more to believe, namely, that God is a person, that he is intelligence, and that intelligence is purpose and plan, that he is will, and that will is realizing purpose, that God is love, and that is, he is person related to person. And then he asks, what if God were not a personality? He said, upon the answer to this question, there depends in no small measure the validity and permanence of all that we have come to mean by religion. If God is not a person, if the divine spirit in whom we live and love and have our being is not personal as we are personal, if the fundamental reality which is in all and through all and over all cannot be addressed by the personal pronoun and cannot be accurately described as a father and friend, then why should we build churches or speak our prayers or join in public worship? And pursuing this thought, Professor Hocking of Harvard University sums it up in a single sentence in his recent book on the meaning of God in human experience. And he says, the alternative to the thought of God as a person is the thought of him as substance or energy, and chiefly as law. Just stop and consider, he says, for a moment, what it would mean for us to try to obey the will of substance, or to love energy, or to worship law. You will have some idea then, at least, of how near this question of the personality of God comes to the heart of religion. Our demand is, and this demand is felt all over the world, that there be somewhere in this universe of ours an understanding Father. As we listen to the television and radio this morning, and as we are made poignantly aware of the dangers that seem to be just ahead, and as our hearts go out in sympathy to the people of Hungary and in anxiety for the situation in the Near East, as we see what is being done with the wonderful inventions of men, and as we contemplate what might be done, I think all of us feels to pause and to appeal to a personal God for personal guidance. And in speaking of these things, I'd like to bring to you a thought with respect to what is, in a sense, the very center and circumference of all religion. If we have a perfect person as an ideal, and if that ideal inspires eventual self-fulfillment in the possibility of becoming a personal person, perfect person, then this God image quality of man, which is the very root of his thought of perfection and is the root of his dignity, then we must not forget that there is a spark in man which is not found in any other of God's creations. And that if we are going to utilize and bring to fruition that holy spark, we as individuals must come to have personal concepts with relation to God and some understanding of our relationship to Him. If we are justified in following the Master's injunction to appeal to Him as our Father who art in heaven, then I think we must conclude that there is a relationship between Him and us, and it is a relationship of parent and child. And if that be true, then on the law of like begets like, we shall become more like Him as we move forward, providing the knowledge we gain is utilized with wisdom, and we can go on unto intelligence. I have spoken for just a moment on the possibilities that lie ahead of man. I'd like now to bring to you the thought that basic to all activity is faith. Faith in ourselves, faith in the ultimate triumph of righteousness, faith in God and in His power and in His love. It was this faith which enabled the ancients to do the things they did. It was this faith which enabled them to subdue kingdoms, stop the mouths of lions, and do all the things of which the apostle writes in the book of Hebrews. It is this faith that we shall need as we go forward if we are to succeed in the stupendous undertaking of living in this modern world. This idea of our divine origin, the purpose and possible destiny of man, should inspire an intelligent and reverent facing of life's experiences, which go on in spite of the changes of the externals of man and of life. A great deal of the Christian religion of the world touches the lives of men at distressingly few points. And we believe that that religion is most potent and most effective, which enters into the lives of men, how they live and love and work and die. That religion should be a vital part and an understanding of God and man's relationship to Him should be of a nature that would enable men in humility to dare to say, as God is, man may become, though the difference between us is inestimably great, given time and God as a teacher, and having the relationship of Father and Son, there is no limit to what man may accomplish in the field of religion as well as in the field of electronics. You who are young should have faith in God enough to carry you through. I read the other day, you are as young as your faith, as old as your doubts, as young as your self-confidence, as old as your fears, as young as your hopes, as old as your despair. And then I like this ancient prayer. I think I like it because it is ancient. Birds of a feather, I suppose. But this ancient prayer reads, from the cowardice that shrinks from new truth, from the laziness that is content with half-truth, from the arrogance that thinks it knows all the truth, O God, deliver us. Now, my young friends, whether you are 17 or 70, there is in every heart a love of wonder, meditation, and thought. And as you go forward to ever higher heights, you're going to find that you scale those heights not to rest, but to go on and on in the pursuit of truth. We cannot live without some basic aspiration. And I'd like to bring to you the thought that awareness, aliveness, are two of the fundamental requisites for this atomic age. And aliveness is in large measure determined by awareness. I guess you'd think I'm rather presumptuous to speak of aliveness in a vital group like this, but I speak of it only to indicate that there should be purpose in your pep. In other words, someone has said, pep without purpose is piffle. Now, our present problem is what higher education is going to do when it confronts the awful monster which higher education, in its technological training, has helped to create. We face a future fraught with limitless possibilities, but with terrific danger. And as we go forward, we're going to need faith, hope, courage, determination, not only to be alive and aware, but to be understanding, to have the kind of faith our mothers had, to have the kind of faith that brought the Pilgrim Fathers to this country, to have the kind of faith that sustained Washington and Lincoln, the kind of faith that enabled the founders of our country to produce the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution of the United States. If it were possible, then, to summarize a rambling talk, I'd simply say this: you live in the greatest age of all time. You will witness greater things than we have ever dreamed. But there are certain eternal verities which change not. There are certain values which endure. You are related to God through faith, coupled with wisdom leading to intelligence, you may become like Him. Keep clean in thought and word and deed. Look up, aspire, push back your horizons. Seek for the answers. Search for God. And may He grant that we all may find Him. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ, amen.